going to talk about authentication and authorization infrastructure at CSCS. So we're going to have an overview about the protocols and the tools we use to manage our infrastructure, identity infrastructure. So I want to set up a common vocabulary so everybody will understand maybe some new terminology. We're going to talk about Keycloak, which is a solution we adopted a few years ago. Then I will briefly explain the difference between OAuth and OIDC, which is a protocol for an identity protocol for the web application and newer application. And then I'll briefly talk about microservices and authentication and authorization techniques. So let's start very simple. So authentication, it's about who are you, while authorization is about what can you do on a system. So an identity provider, or IDP, it's a trusted provider of identity information. So it's commonly backend by resources like LDAP, SQL, where your user base is. And it provides assertion. It's able to construct user attributes through assertion or claims, depending on the protocol. Then we have the service provider that are typically services that consume. So they query the identity provider and they consume identities and attributes. SAN, it's one of the first web protocol. It started with version 1 in 2001. Now it's version 2 that it's dated on 2005. It was a XML-based standard. It approached federated identity, and it's a very verbose protocol that goes through the web. Then we have the newer O2 and OpenID Connect that revisit this way to approach the federated identity, and it ditch XML in favor of JSON. So it's newer. Assertion and claims are how these attributes, after you authenticate through an identity provider, how these attributes are propagating to the service provider. So we talk about assertions when we're using SAML, so it's our XML assertion, or claims, JSON dictionary. So what is Keycloak? I have to do a small introduction. So before we introduce OpenStack at CSCS, our AAI infrastructure was based on LDAP or Kerberos. So because with OpenStack, everything was callable through a REST API, so it was more webbish. So we need a new tool because LDAP or Kerberos was not enough. In addition to that, Keystone, which is the identity component of OpenStack, was not able to talk with our LDAP or Kerberos because of the way we set it up. And we were forced to put a component in the middle, because Keystone was able to talk SAML. So during the various OpenStack summit, we found that Keycloak was a common tool used by other peers. So Keycloak, what it is simply an identity provider, but it's a little bit more. So it offers single sign-on. With single sign-on, the ability to sign up one, and then if the other service provider are part of your what is called realm, you don't need to write your password again, your username and password again, but it's transparent to the user. It offers identity brokering and social login. I'm going to discuss later about that. User federation. With user federation, I mean, you can have your user based on LDAP or relational database, or he has a pluggable interface, so you can write your custom plugin and put your user wherever you want. Client adapters, there are a lot of libraries available on the web, so you can easily integrate your application with KeyClock. And it has a nice and admin-friendly console and also user-friendly account management console. So I already talked about that. The good things about KeyClock, it's OpenID Connect compliant and also SAM2. So it can speak both languages, let's say. There are a lot of flows, user flows already that are easy to configure. Let's say if you want to set up a flow for if a user forgets his password or to verify his user email, it's very simple. You just need to you don't have to do much. Or there are also extension about one-time password, so you can strengthen your security and various workflow. Okay, so identity brokering. Why we choose KeyClock instead of other tools? KeyClock is promising because basically with the identity brokering, I mean the possibility to authenticate through various identity providers. For instance, you can, if your identity provider is listed on KeyClock, KeyClock is delegating to that identity provider the authorization to authenticate. For instance, there are social logins, so you can authenticate through Facebook, through Google, or your another identity provider or of other center. And this is really, we found it really good because maybe we want to set up a federation with other computing center. And this is the right tool that we missed, and now we have. So this is how it looks like. So now if you at CSCS, this is the user interface. As you can see on the right, this is the identity brokering feature that I talk about. So you can authenticate through other identity provider. Of course, there is a trust between us and them, so we know exactly for which service provider you are authenticating. And that's it. So yeah, I already talked about that. So this is how the admin console look like. So you can set up realms, which are how you group the service provider and how you set up single sign-on between them. You can add external identity providers. With user federation, you set up your LDAP Kerberos, whatever. You can, from here, you will manage your users, your group. You can set up which attributes I'm going to release for which service provider and all this fine grain admin. And this is we have to work on this, but this is how it looks, the account and management console, where the user, they can link their identities. For instance, if I authenticate in another identity provider, then I can link my Keycloak identity with that identity provider in order to have just one identity. And then the next time you authenticate is transparent to the application. And from here you can check your session and logs to see how many times and from where you authenticated. And plus, for instance, there are many, with OIDC, you can set up consents. So, for instance, you are delegating to another application to use your Google profile or Google account, and you can set up from here, but I'm going to discuss about this later. So CCS is part of the Phoenix initiative. So this initiative is about to deliver with other peer centers like Cineca, ULIC, BSC, so computing data services to the European researcher. And basically what we are doing is exposing an identity provider, which is going to be an external identity provider connected to our Keycloak, which is going to be called Satosa, and other services, which is going to manage user and authorization and quota between the various data centers. But without Keycloak, this wasn't possible, basically. So Keycloak really helped a lot because of this identity brokering feature. So let's talk about OAuth. So I started looking a few years ago, no, maybe less, and I found it's not easy because there's a lot of confusion between OAuth and OIDC. So there's a lot of jargon, and also on the web sometimes you find incorrect advice. So let's talk about the history. So why is the design OAuth? So we are around in 2006, 2007, and Sun was there. So all the enterprises were using Sun for the single sign-on. But there were new use cases, like the mobile app login. So new mobile login were starting, and they have the problem of, for instance, maintaining a session between when they connect and other project, other problems. But the newer problem was this so-called delegated authorization. So basically this problem was, how can I let a website access my data without giving it my password? So this has happened to you a lot of time. A lot of you use it, they don't know the history. So for instance, when you log into to an application through Google or Facebook, and they ask you for consent, for instance, for using your contacts or your profile on Google. So this is how it started. And so they came up with OAuth, which is an open standard for access delegation. So the key thing is that this standard was born for authorization. Not authentication, but just for authorizing, for the authorization part, which is slightly different. So this is one of the first attempts to solve this problem. So back in the days, Yelp, which is a local search engine. So after you register to Yelp, they will ask you, why don't you give me your username and password for your email. So we may go in, we promise we will use your password, and then we'll discard and not use it maliciously. And we're going to send an invitation to all of your contacts. But this was not the best way. So luckily, we have OAuth. So unfortunately, I have to define a new set of words. So for instance, let's start with the resource owner, which for simplicity, let's say is the end user. So the person who owns the data. For instance, I'm the resource owner of my data on my Google account. The client is the web application or the application that wants to perform action on behalf of the resource owner. Then we have the authentication server, which typically is an identity provider. And then we have the resource server. So the resource server is an API server that is used to access users' information. I'm going to have an example later, so maybe we'll simplify everything. It's important, the concept of the redirect URI, because when you go from a client to an authentication server, after you authenticate, that the authentication server needs to know where to send you back. Then there is the concept of the authorization token, which is an intermediary token generated when a user authorizes a client to access a protected resources. And then we have the access token, which is the final token you get after you finish all the flow. The scopes are, let's say, permissions. So when we want to access a resource server, maybe we want to fine grain, we want to limit the data that we want to share. So we're gonna see the scopes, how they work. So let's start with there are at least three flows. The most secure and the most used is the so-called authorization code flow. So let's say that I'm the client, so I'm building this nextplatform.com. I'm the resource owner, and I want to connect through Google. And my application wants to read all of your contact and your profile information after you are authenticated through Google. So in order to initiate an authorization code flow, you need to set up. You need to pass at the authentication server the redirect URI. So, where do you send me after you authenticate? This special header, HTML header, is called type equal code, and then the scope. So in this way, I'm asking. I need to access the profile of the user and his contacts. So you go to, in this case, accounts.google, set up your username and password, and then it prompts this request. You may have seen a lot of time that, based on the scopes, it asks you, there is this platform called Next Platform, want to access your profile information and your contacts information. Do you allow or not? And if you say no, the code flow finish here. But if you say yes, you are redirected back to the initial redirect URI. And this time, you get back an authorization token, which is an intermediary token. With this token, you come back to your platform, and then you cannot do anything. You can do just one thing. You can go back to the authentication server and say, look, I have this authorization token. Can you give me back an access token? Because I want to access the real resource server. You may notice that this exchange happened in a secure channel. So it's not it's application to application. It doesn't go through the web, through the normal port. So once you got the access token, you finally can contact the resource server. And based on your scopes and the access token, your resource server will give you back all your user profile and the contacts. So OpenID Connect. OpenID Connect is basically just a small layer on top of IDC or of OAuth that define two things, an ID token and a user endpoint info. So basically, what do you do? In order to trigger a OIDC flow, you need to specify a special scope, which is called OpenID, and then you can have additional scopes. And with the ID token, it's a token you get back with the access token. So, but let's see in the example. So this was because OAuth 2 didn't specify the authentication, just the authorization. But with OIDC, they were a need to have a standard way to specify also the authentication. So information about user identity in a standardized way. So we back to the client, our next platform. So this time we ask also an OpenID scope. So because our authentication server is OIDC compliant, this is the same. We get the authorization token. We come back to our client with the authorization token. Now this time when we exchange the authorization token, we get back an access token and an ID token because we ask for a scope OpenID. With this scope, with the ID token, we can query the authentication server in the user info endpoint when we can have standard information about user identity. And then, see, he knows that I'm Massimo. For instance, he can have a profile picture, an email, and other information. So this is a very simple web client I developed against our KeyClock instance. So you come here, you log in with CSS KeyClock. It prompts our interface. And then it will ask you, do you want to allow this application for this setup scope? If you click yes, you come back to the application and see, this is how I look. On the first part, there are the information on the user profile of the ID token, and then the access token. But these tokens are in this form. This form, it's a Base64 encode. So basically, are in plain text. It's easy to decode a Base64. The only thing is they are digitally signed with the client, they previously exchanged between the authorization server and your client. So this is how it looks like, an ID token. And it's easy to decode. It's made of three parts. The header, which explains which algorithm are you using to sign, the payload, and the signature. So it's now everybody's talking about microservices, but it would be nice also at CSS to have an API, a set of APIs where you can you can use your center, for instance, for to set up a job on the supercomputer, or you want to move file, or you want to do everything through REST API. So that's why they come to the microservices. An API gateway, it's a way to simplify, to have a single access to all your microservices. It helps the user, because the user doesn't have to have a list of API, so he will have a single access point. And also the developer of the microservices, because they it's easier for them, for instance, to reroute a service to another server or to manage their APIs. So lately we start using Kong, which is the an open source API gateway. So basically an API is something you put on top of your resource server, of your source of APIs. And with Kong you can do a lot of cool stuff, like you can manage quota of your API, you can set up rate limiting, caching, you can check the health of your APIs, and plus it has a lot of plugin for authenticating the JWT token, so the access token. So it perfectly suit it's fit for the OIDC and the OAuth world. So this is my last slide. It's about KS proxy. So because we put Keycloak in front of OpenStack, so it was difficult to use the command line interface and get a token and get an authentication through a command line interface, because we had Keycloak in front. So Keycloak it's a web application. So that's why we developed this KS proxy. So it's a simple proxy that will handle all the exchange of assertion with the Keycloak. So basically we can authenticate through OpenStack via command line interface. So if somebody is interested about this project, it's published on our GitHub, and they can contact me later. So conclusion, so in modern security standard, it's all about tokens. It's always good to decouple authenticate with authorization. Claims are newer than assertion, and they can be invalidated because they have additional information with a timeline defined. So they can be invalidated. It's in a central manner. So from the Keycloak you can invalidate the session. And it's always easy if you have services like Keycloak where you can delegate the authentication and the authorization instead of using your custom solution or develop a new solution. So that was pretty much it. Thank you.